I grew up in the Middle West, Jewish. My father was an advertising man, and had been. My mother was went to the university in as a dietitian, so I grew up in a upper middle class family, I suppose, in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Went to public schools. My parents were not intellectuals. The big sociological experience of my life was moving to Los Angeles when I was 15. I think that's the first time I had a sense of the variation of human life and saw how different people my age were in another part of the United States. And that, I think, was a formative experience for me. Then I went to Harvard and became very involved in left-wing student politics, what we call sex, drugs, and rock and roll, and SDS. I also was a journalist for the Harvard Crimson, which was a very influential college newspaper from which many professional journalists emerged and considered for a long time going into journalism, worked on newspapers in the summer. And I suppose the other notable thing about my undergraduate life was that I was more interested in the humanities courses than in the social science courses. I liked literature, drama, history of art. I was in a major called social studies that was organized by Michael Walzer and Barrington Moore, which was an interdisciplinary major, we called it, that had emphasis on social theory, and I only took a sociology course at the end of my time at Harvard. So I made the decision to go to sociology to pursue this project of trying to get a grip on my time, my society, and I think I disappointed my parents, who wanted me to have a steady job and become a professional. In sociology, there's always a big, big conflict between empirical work and theoretical work. And in American sociology, particularly, I think there's a bias against theory. American sociology is wonderfully problem-driven in terms of poverty, inequality, racism, gender, crime, organizational sociology. And there's a sense that that's why you become a sociologist, is to answer practical questions in the society, and there's a tremendous emphasis on methods, quantitative methods, qualitative methods. But you lose any big view. So you're involved in digging down, but in a narrow way. And you don't get rewards in American sociology from thinking of large theoretical, large questions about the whole society, the trends of history. People would ask you, what's the proof? How can you prove what you're saying?
Where's the evidence?
Yeah, and you can't prove large-scale generalizations. You mainly can illustrate them, perhaps, and try to give compelling evidence of them. And much less the issue of meta-theoretical, which is theories about theory, theories about what social science is or what the human sciences are. So I was in a very, I would say, very non-conformist relationship to American sociology, very antagonistic relationship. I was very critical of empiricism and of the direction of American sociology. That's why I started Theoretical Logic, the introduction, with the quote was, if sociology could speak, it would say, I am tired. I should also say that the Berkeley department was a good place to be a young theorist in rebellion against American empiricism, because it had many interesting people who were theorists, like my advisors, Neil Smelser and Robert Bella. Both were students of Parsons, and both, Bella was a famous student of Durkheim, a scholar of Durkheim. They were very encouraging, although worried about me, because I didn't know if I could get a job. I tried to undermine the empiricism, the false realism of American sociology, and to show that there are always philosophical presuppositions. Therefore, if there are, then it's legitimate to work on them too. I mean, there were so many different aspects of those four volumes, many different elements of my argument. Certainly one was a defense of theory, which I consider a defense of the mind. There's a kind of a way of thinking about social science as if there isn't a mind involved, that you just throw yourself and you find reality. I wanted people to realize that it's a mental construction of the social world, and that we bring theories consciously and unconsciously into play, that we learn theoretical and methodological things in undergraduate, in graduate school, from reading, that it's absurd to say that we're finding what really is there. It's a hermeneutical exercise. We're reconstructing what's there according to theoretical ideas that we have. Did it have I don't know. I think we still have these arguments in American sociology. I don't know whether, I think it's less so in most European places. We have arguments about the relative role of theory, and some people say you don't need theory. You can, certainly not general theory. Some people say we don't need to teach the classics, et cetera, et cetera. But the book had so many other elements too. It was an argument, of course, it was a critique of Marxism. It was a critique of materialism. It offered a reconstruction of Weber's work that said Weber didn't have a theory of modernity that was related to meaning and culture. And in that sense, it challenged both Parsonian and other kinds of theories of understanding of Weber. And then it introduced a new understanding of Durkheim that said that the works of Durkheim that were studied, we can talk about this later, the works of the 90s are not the most important work of Durkheim. And then, of course, it made a case for Parsons at the very time when Parsons was losing his influence in American sociology. So even though it offered a critique of Parsons, it was more of an internalist than an externalist critique. All of those things reverberated, I think, in American sociology. My book, those books were reviewed in very conspicuous ways, in long essays, in most of the journals. They were often reviewed very polemically. There was a lot of antagonism to my work, both by people my own age who were part of a more radical materialism, who felt I was going backwards, not forwards. In my work on Durkheim, I discovered what I thought was a new way of thinking about Durkheim that was actually in a great deal of tension with Parsons' value analysis. And I was only barely conscious of that when I published the book. So when I look back at theoretical logic, I think that there was a tension there that different layers of my mind had been working on. And that in the years afterward, as I began to create a cultural sociology that was in conflict with Parsons' value analysis, that I was going back to something I had done in theoretical logic, but hadn't been aware that it was going to cause me both the problems and give me the resources imaginatively to create a different theory. My argument about Durkheim, of course, was that Durkheim really was trying to create a new kind of sociology of modernity. When he did his work on the Aboriginal peoples and the elementary forms of religious life, as he says in the first page of that 1911 book, it's 11 or 1912 book, I am not studying primitive religion because I'm interested in Aborigines, but I'm interested in the religious man of today. I and other people argued that there was a break in Durkheim's consciousness, his perception, even his emotional life in the late 1890s, and that he tried to turn his whole group to focus on religious elements and primitive societies. Some of the most critical chapters of Elementary Forms are written as much in the present tense about France of his time as they are about Aborigines, as he goes back and forth between an ancient past and the present. So I believe that Durkheim's theory of what I came to call the binary codes, sacred and profane, or what he would call the positive and negative sacred, the idea of ritual, symbol, and effervescence and solidarity, he believed could become the basis for a theory of modern society, a very different theory that was very cultural, very fluid, very dynamic, and not morphological in the way that he had emphasized in the works of the 90s. In terms of Durkheim, what I said was that I introduced the notion of late Durkheim. Mm. And today in cultural sociology, everybody relates cultural sociology to what they call late Durkheim. Mm. Or we sometimes called it late Durkheimian sociology. And to us, The Elementary Forms wasn't a book for anthropology, which is, that book had been interpreted for 50 years, or maybe 60 or 70 years, as the foundations of anthropology, an entirely different discipline, and it had tremendous effects, I mean, on French, British, and American anthropology. But we interpreted it as the ground base classic for cultural sociology, a contemporary cultural sociology. But it had to be combined, or we combined this with a number of other theoretical and philosophical developments, which some of which I argued grew out of Durkheim,
mm-hmm.
like Saussurean linguistics, the idea of structuralism in linguistics, which created the field of semiotics, which created Levi-Strauss, and his structural anthropology was tremendously important to the way I understand cultural sociology. Roland Barthes, Roman Jakobson, who was a Prague, part of the Slavic linguistics, who had a big, he had a big influence on Levi-Strauss. He was much more pragmatically oriented, but he strongly emphasized binarism and the importance and defended that. Those movements and are what allowed me to, I stirred them into the late Durkheim to come out with, I think, a much more complex and relevant toolkit of theories. If you just work with the elementary forms, I don't see how you can really do cultural analysis of a complex society, indeed even of an early society. You need these other tools too, which are completely consistent with the core ideas Durkheim had. In addition, you need theories of narrativity. And because codes and narrative theory provide a richer sense of the moral and cognitive contents of symbols and myths. You need a theory of myth. Durkheim understood the whole, but he obviously didn't understand, in a way, how the parts needed to be constructed, I would say. So, and then one more thing is, in the background, you have the linguistic turn in philosophy, and especially Wittgenstein's later work. And this had a big influence on me and gave me much more confidence that you needed to move from consciousness to texts. So, and the idea of text, of course, is related to the notion of discourse, and this became such an important concept in post-structuralism, in the early Foucault. So the movement, in a way, from action to text, the tools to analyze social texts, this was a critical move for me. And I tried to argue that social science needed to make that move towards a theory of the social text. This was and is very difficult for sociologists and I think social scientists in general to allow that to happen. Of course, it's much easier for humanists who analyze texts, movies, paintings, or novels and poems. But social scientists look at people, real people doing real things in a pragmatic context. And if you say, but we have to pay attention, we have to step back from these living and breathing people and try to understand the texts which influence them, it's counterintuitive to most people, and they accuse you of being like an idealist or a cultural determinist or whatever the accusation against structuralism, you know, was. A person's mind is very complicated, and we don't understand our own thought. One of the main themes of theoretical logic was that you had to always have a symbolic element or a cultural or a moral element, that was a dimension of every action, of every organization, whether economic, or religious. I argued for an analytical approach to culture, such that that nothing was without meaning, and that if you didn't have that understanding, then you would end up in reduction. In that sense, and so I followed that through Marx, through Durkheim, through Weber, and through Parsons, this theme of the relative, what I came later to call the relative autonomy of culture. In that book, I talked about multi-dimensionality. Now, my work then, that is in, has basically tried to fulfill that idea, how to pursue the idea of how do we understand meaning as a dimension? And what kind of theoretical tools do we need? At the time, I thought the only tools we needed was the classical tradition plus Parsons. That his approach, the functionalist approach to values, was a sufficient way of talking about the cultural or dimension of meaning. The break in my work was as I came to realize that values was actually a very inadequate way. The hermeneutic tradition and the traditions that I became interested in, which are semiotics, narrative theory, theories of binary relations, have allowed us to understand that people they live in worlds of meaning that are constructed of stories. Stories that people from Aristotle on have understood in terms of temporality, beginning, middles, and ends. And with protagonists and antagonists. And what the Durkheimian tradition has started, and the semiotics and structuralist and post-structuralists have built up, is the idea of binary codes, sacred and profane. And then there's ideas of metaphors and symbols and icons, so that what I ended up believing is that we needed to have a much different and richer conceptual language to understand meaning making, therefore the cultural dimension that I had defined in theoretical logic. And that if we did, then we would really be able to theorize culture in modern societies, and that values weren't the way to go. I mean, psychoanalysis is a great example of hermeneutics. The therapist has the statements by the patient, but he or she has to find the pattern that they reveal, and that's an act of imagination. I introduced the notion of civil sphere and argue that this is the best way in a modern society of talking about civil society, and that civil society in the way people talk about it today is mostly inadequate to understand the problems and the possibilities of justice in a complex world. It's a vocabulary that emerges in the 17th through the 19th century and has to do with the transition of society away from kingships and the opening up of free association in society, whether it's in business, religion, or in public life. That idea of civil society was revived with the movements away from dictatorship in South America in the 80s and in Eastern Europe under communism, because that was the same kind of exact same kind of situation as had existed in the West in the 17th, 18th, and 19th centuries, the movement away from an absolutist state. The problem with that way of thinking of civil society is that once you've moved towards a, let's say, a democracy, a formal democracy, then the theory of civil society is ended. It doesn't have any critical purchase, in my view anyway. So I wanted to introduce a different idea, which is more Durkheimian and more Parsonian, the notion that instead of focusing on association, we need to focus on solidarity, of a sphere of solidarity, which is a moral world that's utopian and democratic, that combines a respect for individual autonomy and emphasizes collective responsibility at the same time. I said that this has been ideal of democratic theory going back to Socrates and up through Rawls. It's very much there. But it's also been part of the moral aspirations of social movements of Christianity and Judaism, of medieval parliaments, of movements to build nations, and certainly the socialist and workers' movements. So I'm not really concerned with the inputs to how this is. I acknowledge there are many, but there is this sphere, and I wanted to define the logic of that, which we could talk about, but this sphere then is in tension with, for example, the market, the state, with religion, with family life, and with primordial ethnic and racial groupings. If we transform the language of civil society into civil sphere, then we have a new kind of critical, but empirical and cultural theory. So my object was to create a new object for social science, this thing called the civil sphere, and I want to develop that in order to develop what I call a sociology of civil repair. We can understand the dark side, and we can also understand the hopeful side of contemporary societies.
And what is the dark side of contemporary society?
Well, another thing that I do in the civil sphere, I mean, I'm in a dialogue, I would say, with Habermas's idea of the public sphere and with Hannah Arendt behind him. With Habermas and the idea of the public sphere, you have two things that are very problematic. One is an emphasis on rational speech and on discourse as the main carrier of moral criticism and moral possibility. The other is a positive view of publicness, or let's say of civil society. It's a long story, public sphere, civil society. So one of the things that I wanted to do first is to say that the civil sphere is based on sacred and profane binaries, not on rational discourses. That these are, there has to be, in a sense, a religion of the civil sphere. And that this religion, with a small r, makes its impact through social dramas, through performances that evoke deeply felt narrative stories and can create movements for purification, pollution, and catharsis. So I put the civil sphere and the possibilities for justice into an aesthetic, moral, and affective context and move very far away from a Socratic notion of giving reasons and justifications, which many people might consider dangerous. There's a lot of arguments. Don't aestheticize. That's fascism. That's, you're encouraging the worst in people. I think that's nonsense, and that a narrowly rationalist view of democracy is simply untenable. So that's one of the ways. In that sense, I think my work is more positively related to Arendt's notion of action in the public than to Habermas. But the other way I depart is by saying that there's always a dark side to the civil sphere. And the reason is because the discourse of the civil sphere is a set of binary codes that, for example, rational, irrational, honest, deceitful, cooperative, aggressive, that these binaries, which are semiotic codes, are what allow people to understand what a good society is, but only in contrast to what's bad. All those bad things that what Durkheim would call the negative sacred are polluted, and if people are thought to be those bad things, they can't be allowed to be inside of the civil sphere because they don't have the qualities that can sustain a democratic, free society. The very act of institutionalizing the civil sphere creates a whole range of exclusions and dominations, not just inclusions. This means that the exclusion of, let's say, the working class, non-white people, non-Christian peoples, women in a complex manner, and also can all, in my model, be understood in a systemic way. I instead see contradictions at the basis of the civil sphere, which then sets up the dynamics that explain social movements. The need for myth, ritual, and sacrality are impossible to eliminate, so it's really a matter of false consciousness. I think it's a bad idea to for modern people to think that non-rational stuff is bad. It's a bad idea for intellectuals or leaders to try to build societies that would do away with this, or for people to think that it's bad that they can do, because it doesn't happen. So you can try to build an atheistic communist society, which would be built on social engineering and on rationality and secular morals, but you end up with a highly mythological communism built on charismatic heroes, rituals, extremely simplistic binary codes, etc. So in the very act of thinking you can do something else, you're in a way crippling the ability for people to see what's actually being constructed. So I'm not too worried about society eliminating those things. I don't think it can. But it is important to... But I think that my quarrel with a lot of Durkheimian and cultural theory is that it's too conservative and is often defends tradition and looks back to a past without conflict, without critique, without an emphasis on rationality, and doesn't put a value on individual autonomy. As we moved out of the 20th century, people became many people, not everybody, became more aware that religion would not, traditional religion with a capital R, wouldn't be eliminated, that people could continue to believe in God and still accept all the other aspects of modernity, or maybe not, some not, but that the idea of belief shouldn't be such a gigantic issue. Human beings have believed in myth and the sacred and profane for 100,000 years since the emergence of Homo sapiens sapiens. It's highly doubtful that the mind has changed in, let's say, the last 100 years. So we're the same, but we can evolve new moral concerns and new kinds of social structures within this context. So I would say that rationality, autonomy, and justice are themselves myths, are themselves sacred beliefs. Just as Durkheim said that individuality, the cult of the individual, was a critical element. And in my work on the civil sphere, that's really been what it's devoted to, that there is the sphere of justice in contemporary societies is a sphere of sacrality and discourse. It's not a sphere of tradition and deference to authority. Ritual is the main way that Durkheim, in the elementary forms, explained powerful symbolic action.
Okay.
And therefore, almost everybody who's been moved and inspired by the late Durkheim has used the idea of ritual to describe social actions that are strongly symbolically, that are very cultural. And I was myself, I used the same idea, the rituals of Watergate and ritual. Phil Smith wrote something on war as ritual. We all did this, Bella, civil religion, ritual occasions, because the idea of ritual suggests homogeneity in a society, and it suggests that when people present totemic things, that everybody accepts that and participates in a solidaristic way. But as you move towards a more fragmented society, you have a lot of failed rituals. A lot of groups would like to create, have a strong symbolic impact, but they can't. A lot of teachers would like to create a ritual out of a class. A lot of priests or rabbis want every Sunday to be a ritual, but in fact, it's not. So how can somebody who's very inspired by the late Durkheim, how can we understand this problem? The idea of a failed ritual is not very appealing, because it didn't fail completely, it just failed a little. So what I gradually came to understand was maybe we should reconceptualize symbolic action in theatrical terms as performances, which are efforts to project meanings to audiences, which therefore the text becomes a background part. You allow creativity for an actor, whether it's an individual or a group. You separate the receivers of these messages so that they become potentially skeptical audiences. And you can then incorporate demographic difference, which we all are very aware of. And then you can use theatrical ideas like mise-en-scène and the means of symbolic production, and you can put power into this, and you can get the role of critics. Maybe there's that symbolic actions aren't either ritual or not, but are more fluid, dynamic attempts to create a fusion of these elements. So when an actor really connects with an audience, and there's a sense of no sense of division anymore, and people feel that they are entering into the narrative and the myth, then we have a ritual. And that's a possibility. But usually things are kind of less than that, and there are ritual moments, but there's still power. There's symbolic power, some solidarity, but also opposition.